17, and here we will discuss about Taylor's theorem and the related concept based on Taylor's theorem and how Taylor's theorem is playing an important role in order to approximate a function. Generally, function, we are having very small class of function that happens to be nice function, elementary kind of function, about which we know everything. Most of things we know about that. So what we will do with the help of those existing functions, we will come up with idea of local understanding of the general function, local understanding of more general function, and what kind of behavior that would have, local behavior. So locally, everything would be locally in nature. Well, that means we just deal in a small neighborhood of that interval, any point. Okay, so those things we will discuss in detail here in today's lecture. So first I have to state the Taylor's theorem, what does it say and what are the geometrical meaning of Taylor's theorem, and further examples, several examples of Taylor's theorems would be there. So coming to outline of today's lecture, I would like to discuss first Taylor's polynomial. It is really very interesting to define first Taylor's polynomial. It would be just a polynomial kind of function, and everyone might be aware of Taylor polynomial structure, that how easy to deal with polynomial structure, because if you are having polynomial structure, you can talk about differentiability as much as possible. So that one is enough smooth. That polynomial function happens to be enough smooth, but we come up with a special kind of Taylor polynomial that we are calling it Taylor's polynomial. It is defined through existence of n number of derivative of a function. Okay, so it defines with the help of derivative of function at a point of various order. So with the help of that, we are defining Taylor's theorem, and based on Taylor's theorem, we try to approximate any function which happens to be differentiable up to n times, and we try to approximate that function with the help of a Taylor polynomial of degree n. So that would be our intention, and that in that process we come across to see Taylor's theorem. What is Taylor's theorem, and that we will discuss. Okay, that means simply I would like to say that if you are having any function which is enough smooth or differentiable n times differentiable up to nth order and differentiability it is having, then always you can bifurcate that function in two form. One form that we are calling it Taylor's theorem, Taylor's polynomial, and we will denote that Tn of x, that means it is a polynomial locally defined, plus there would be remainder term after n, remainder Rn generally. So this would be also a function of x. So remainder term. So, and here what is that? All about approximation. In the process of approximation, we are talking about how well this Taylor polynomial is approximating the given function. And when approximation is happening, that means when we talk about approximation of fx by Taylor's polynomial, then at the same point, that approximation can be established by finding limiting value of this remainder. Limiting value of this remainder, when n is approaching to infinity, when it is approaching to zero, then we say that the Taylor polynomial is approximating the given function. So approximation concept is coming. If provided the remainder, simply we will find a limit of this remainder after n term, when n is approaching to infinity, the remainder would approach to zero. That is the concept of approximation. So we'll discuss this approximation concept in detail in the further lecture as well, from the application point of view. Afterward, I will talk about Taylor's polynomial and how it is playing important role in the process of approximating a function which happens to be enough smooth. So how we can approximate that function by a Taylor's polynomial, that approximation we'll discuss in detail. After that, what is happening that we will come up with any kind of function, and we try to approximate that function. We will try to approximate that function away from the non-local way, that away from x naught. That means we will come up with a small neighborhood of around x naught. X naught would be our given point. We can call it is initial point or given point. So there would be a delta neighborhood of that point. You can denote it by delta around x naught, Okay, so approximation whether it is valid if you go away from this delta neighborhood of x naught. So what kind of problem you will face, that thing we will discuss in detail. So simply it will just signify further that just we are dealing in local neighborhood of x naught. We are not trying to go away from x naught as much as possible. If you are trying to go away from x naught, then we have to take different approach. So what approach that would be, that we will discuss here. So coming to first that Taylor polynomial and Taylor theorem, what is that? I have to describe these things, then I will go further. So let me introduce Taylor's polynomial. What does it talk about? So suppose we are having a point x naught which belongs to an interval, open interval. Generally, whenever we are talking about differentiability of a function, always we deal with open neighborhood or open interval. That delta neighborhood always happens to be an open interval. So that's why if nothing is mentioned there, you consider that it happens to be an open interval. So that's why we are taking x naught from this open interval, so that we can say that we will get a delta neighborhood around x naught which will be within I. So that's why we are taking in that perspective. And suppose a function which is defined from the interval I to R, and it is that function is having finite derivatives up to nth order in inclusive manner, okay, at x naught. That means locally it is defined. Derivative always defined locally, like limit and continuity, it is also defined locally, local concept it happens to be. Then we can define Taylor's polynomial of the nth order in this way. So Taylor polynomial of the given function f, you can call it at x naught or in the small neighborhood of x naught, both happen to be equivalent to each other. So Tn, the Taylor polynomial in the small neighborhood of x naught, we are defining this way, t of x with suffix n, it is f of x naught, this value of the function at point x naught plus first derivative of function at point x naught divided by factorial n times x minus x naught plus second derivative of function at point x naught divided by factorial 2 times x minus x naught whole square. And likewise, you will go to nth term. This easily you can see that. So nth, this n is directly borrowed from that we are taking function f is differentiable n times. So there exists finite derivative up to order n. So that's why we are defining an n degree polynomial. So this specific n degree polynomial, here you can see that coefficients are determined from the various derivative of the function. That's why we are saying that this Tn happens to be a Taylor polynomial of degree n of the given function f at x naught. That we can say that. So that this one is the Taylor polynomial associated with f. Okay. So each function will have different Taylor's polynomial, because you can easily see that your Taylor polynomial, your coefficients are determined by various derivative of the function at x naught. So that's why if you change the function, you will have different Taylor's polynomial. So few example I would like to talk geometry. I will talk. So Taylor polynomial for the exponential function e to the power of x in the neighborhood of 0, it can be depicted. You can see it here. Various degree polynomial, 1 degree t1 degree 1 polynomial, t2 degree 2 polynomial, t3 degree 3. So t1 degree, that means degree 1, that means it would be a linear polynomial, it would be quadratic, it would be cubic, and it would be biquadratic. This kind of polynomial, Taylor polynomial, we will get for e to the power x or exponential function. So you can visualize like this way. So this one is exponential function, that this blue line. And if you talk about first order approximation, first term, that means degree 1 Taylor polynomial t1, that we don't, it would be a line. You can see that this is the degree 1 polynomial t1, we denote it. If it is increase the degree t2, then it would be this polynomial t2 means it is taking derivative of, what would be that what are the various derivative of f this e to the power x? Anyone would like to say that what is the kth derivative of e to the power x? Anyone? What is e to the power x? It's just for every k, every integer, positive integer k, so or natural number, better take it natural number. So it is, so that's the way we can write it like that. So in that perspective, what would be t1? T1 would be 1 plus, it is just dealing with first order derivative, x by 1, x by 1 is 1 itself. And apart from that, what is f0? So we are finding Taylor's polynomial about 0, that means f0 is here 0. So all the information are given here. And so we will be able to write various Taylor polynomial. What would be second degree Taylor polynomial? It would be 1 plus x square by factorial 2. Quadratic kind of polynomial. Easily we can see that. So we call it, this one is T2. Likewise, T3 would be cubic polynomial 1 plus x plus x square by factorial 2 plus x cube by factorial 3, that means 6. You can write it directly. So likewise also you can write T4, it would be by quadratic kind of polynomial. So all these are the plot of various Taylor polynomial of exponential function. Now if we come across another function, sine of x. So if I talk about sine of x, what is the kth derivative of sine of x? Anyone? So various Taylor polynomial of sine of x is already written here. So here only odd kind of situation would come here. So this one is talking about T1. It would be by default, it would be linear. So what would be this T1 would be just x. What would be T2? T2, there is no concept of T2. There would be T3. This is T3. It would be cubic x minus x cube by factorial 3. That means 6. Then x5, it would be quantic polynomial x minus x cube by factorial 3, that means 6, plus x to the power 5, factorial 5. Okay, write factorial 5. So likewise you can write down all the Taylor's polynomial of this sine function. Okay, and if you try to zoom out this one, then approximation is valid up to here in a very small neighborhood. You can see that neighborhood is 0, approximation is very fine. But if you go away, just there is a deviation. You can see that this linear function, it is very far away from the sine function. Actual sine function is going like this sinusoidal function. It is like this oscillatory kind of function. So you can see that x is, if you go away from origin, this T1 is very far away from this sine x. Okay, but if you are in very small neighborhood of 0, then in that case x is near to sin x, and also we can say that T3 is also near to sin x, T4 is that one is part of approximation. Right now I am not discussing approximation, I am just discussing about Taylor's polynomial of a given function. So that's why just visualize all these Taylor's polynomial. What are these Taylor polynomial? How you come up with Taylor polynomial for a given function? So that is the idea. No, there is a proof that there is no need to remember it. Simply you come up with a proof, is very simple. It is not like that difficult kind of proof. You come up with just you have to determine the coefficient of that polynomial, and coefficient would be expressed in term of derivative. It is all about simply I would like to say that easily you can determine those coefficient in term of derivative of the function. So what you do, if you are going for suppose your function f is 3 times differentiable, then what you do, so you will talk about cubic approximation of that function. The corresponding Taylor polynomial would be cubic, so you can write it like a naught plus a1 x plus a2 x square plus a3 x cube x cube. So you are going for cubic expression of the polynomial. Suppose you this function, it would be known to you. So if suppose you take f of x equal to sin x, then how you can determine x naught? Easily you can determine in term of derivative. So what would be x naught? How you can determine x naught? You substitute x equal to 0 here. X equal to 0. What you will get? What would be a naught? If you are substituting here, x equal to 0 here, you call it equation 1. This one is given function. You can call equation 2. There is no issue. So in equation 1, substitute x equal to x naught equal to 0. Just you try to find this Taylor polynomial in the neighborhood of 0. So if you are taking x naught equal to 0, so what would be f of 0? F of 0, that means sine of 0. Sine of 0 is 0. And in right hand side, what you will observe, all the these terms would vanish. Only we will have a naught. So from here, it implies a naught equal to 0. Likewise, go to find a1. How you can find a1? So differentiate this one 1 times, and after that substitute x not equal to 0. So if you are differentiating this one 1 time, then f dash would be what? F dash, it would be equal to cosine of x. And in right hand side, you observe derivative, this would vanish. It is already 0. No worry. So just differentiate these terms. So you will have a1 plus, other x time, I'm writing it x time, all these vectors. So again, put x not equal to 0. What does it will give? It will give a1 equal to x. Sorry, a1 equal to 1. It will give a1 equal to 1. Substitute again x naught here. Take x naught equal to 0. Then you will get a1 equal to 1. Likewise, what is 1? You have to focus on. 1 is actually talking about derivative of the first derivative of the function at point 0. It is first derivative of the function at point 0. Likewise, what would be a2? It would be 0. And that one is actually what? It is talking about second derivative of the function at point 0. And what would be a3? And so while getting a3, also you will have that 3 times you have to differentiate. So this time, this side factorial 3 would also come. Factorial 3 times a3. Here factorial 2 times a2. So that proof is very simple. It is, there is no issue. It would be equal to minus 1. And that one is what? It is very simple. 3 times you are differentiating. So first time you, when you are differentiating, 3 will come. Then second time when you are differentiating, then 2 will again come. Third time you, when you are differentiating, here x to the power 3 is coming now. 3 times when you differentiate x to the power 3 times, how many so that factor will come now? That exponent will come. So that's where it is coming. Factor 3 times a3 equal to minus 1. That one is third derivative of the function at point 0. And from here you can conclude that a3 is what? a3 is equal to minus 1 times factorial 3, or you can call it third derivative of the function at point 0 divided by factorial 3. So same thing is coming. It is just very simple that you come up with this kind of polynomial and find the, determine the coefficient. If you are aware of coefficient, that means you are aware of polynomial. So that is the concept. Easily you can determine for so that is the deterministic approach to find a Taylor's polynomial for a given function. Okay, I think it would be clear to everyone. So we'll discuss other time. So these are very elementary kind of things. So you might have already seen that in your plus two. I don't want to discuss all these. So I have to go more deeper concept. Those are very much essential from the application point of view. Those things I would like to discuss. How you can take benefit of this Taylor's polynomial in your application. and how much important this one, so that thing we will discuss in detail here. So once we are having Taylor's polynomial, then we can talk about Taylor's theorem. What does Taylor's theorem, it looks like? How it is different from Taylor's polynomial? Because Taylor's polynomial, it was not a theorem. It was just dealing with how to come up with Taylor's polynomial of a given function, differentiable in a smooth function. Okay. So we are defining Taylor's theorem like this way, that suppose we are having a function which is defined over an interval I to R, and X naught is belongs, it is a member of this interval, and this f is having finite derivative up. Derivatives up to order n. Okay, then Taylor's polynomial we are defining like this way. We had already discussed it is an n degree polynomial, and where coefficients are determined by remember that polynomial vary with respect to coefficient. So you need to know what is the coefficient. So simply in Taylor's polynomial, coefficients are determined by the respective derivative of the function. Respective derivative of the function. So that's where we are coming with this, that concept. So once we are having Taylor's polynomial, we are talking about Taylor's theorem. What does it say? Suppose we are having a function which is differentiable up to nth order. It is differentiable up to nth order. So n may, might be greater than or equal to 1, n may be 2, n may be 3, n may be 4. Depends upon, it depends upon what kind of function is there. So based on that, it would be. It would be very much subjective in nature, simply I would like to say that. So Tn, we are having a function which is differentiable up to nth order, and Tn in that process we are having Tn as an nth degree Taylor polynomial of that function. Then we can say that if you define limiting value of this one, limiting value of this divided difference, what we call it, so it will approach to zero when x is approaching to infinity. The f of x minus tn divided by x minus x naught to the power n, it will approach to zero when x is approaching to infinity. It is a little bit implicit kind of approach. What is explicit? That explicit form I am defining it like this way. So it says that if you are having a function f which is differentiable up to nth order, then that function can be written as in two form. One, this as a sum of Taylor's polynomial, nth degree Taylor's polynomial, plus this one is what we call it remainder after enter, remainder Rn. So always we can write that function in two form. And now further, what is condition? So we need to put a condition over this remainder after enter. What is that condition? That condition is that it must approach to zero when x is approaching to infinity. So condition when x is approaching to x naught. So in that case, the remainder after n term, it will approach to zero. So just don't focus on this. This one is all, again, it is coming in term of polynomial in x. Don't worry about that. This term, this coefficient of x, this term is very much important. So it would be just beneficial to understand how it would approach to zero. So simply you can say that this coefficient is containing a terms implicitly in the form of x minus x naught. So you know that when if this coefficient of in the remainder term, if it contains this x minus x naught implicitly, then when x is approaching to x naught, this will approach to zero. So due to that, this coefficient will approach to zero, and hence we can say that limiting value of this en is equal to zero. Okay, so this generally we are calling it remainder term, remainder after nth term. Okay, so here there are various different explicit form of this Rnx. So one explicit form is given by Lagrange. So we'll discuss remainder term from the Lagrange perspective. The perspective, what does that talk about? So we'll see it here like this way. So that's why I'm giving another form of Taylor's theorem. So again, we are having a function which is differentiable up to nth order. In that process, we got Taylor's polynomial of degree n of that function. Okay, then that function can be written in two form, can be bifurcated in two form. This form we are calling it Taylor's polynomial of degree n plus remainder after n term. Okay, remainder after Taylor polynomial. So remainder, this remainder is very much essential to understand. There are various forms of this remainder. One interesting form of that remainder is defined by this way. It is directly coming from mean value theorem, and this remainder after n term has been introduced by what we call it Lagrange. So this one is remainder after automatically use. You can see that here it is coming the idea that up to nth here when you try to find nth derivative of the function, factorial n is coming there. Factorial in the denominator, factorial n is coming there. So that's why if you are willing to find n plus 1th term, so derivative by default factorial n of n plus 1 will come here. So that's why from there this idea has been taken. So all about to focus would be in Taylor's theorem is that how to make this limit to converge to 0. And here it is a condition that c is not x naught. C is any point between x and x naught. C is any point between x and x naught. That remember that. That you have to remember that. So and c is highly dependent on the arbitrary point in the neighborhood of x naught. That happens to be x. So it is highly dependent on that. Okay. And c lies between either left side of left side of x naught or right side of x naught. It depends on from where x you are taking, because here you are dealing in the small neighborhood of x naught. So x, you are free to take x from left side of x naught or right side of x naught in the delta neighborhood of x naught. You are free to take x from right or left, so there is no any issue. So that's why so based on x c would be decided. So it is just what we call it mean value theorem concept. It is coming like that. So the remainder term here in the Taylor theorem, it can be used to estimate the error in the process of approximating the function by corresponding Taylor's polynomial. So always we try to approximate a given function by a corresponding Taylor polynomial, this Taylor polynomial. And when we do approximation, by default error would come here, because it is talking about approximation, because there is a remainder term. So remainder term, we have to talk about here finite n. It is not like that n would go to infinity. It is not always feasible kind of thing. So we have to talk about finite n. In case of finite n, then that definitely, if a function is approximated by this one, then error contribution, so it will be converted into en. Simply that's why en notation I had taken. So en. So what is the error? If you are just trying to approximate a given function by n degree polynomial, in that process what error you are getting, so you have to find it out. So we will talk about error analysis as well in the process of while approximating a function by corresponding Taylor theorem. Okay, so if the number, so what is happened, that situation, there would be various situation. If the number n is prescribed, then that means if n is given, simply I would like to say that when n is given to you, then question would be the accuracy of the approximation error. That means what is the error? What is the error? Accuracy, this means what is the error? We have to find the error. Okay. How much error you are committing in the process of approximation of the function by corresponding Taylor's polynomial? What is the error? So that we have to find. In other hand, suppose error is given, that means you are allowed to commit this much amount of error or this much amount of that would be certain given accuracy. Then question would be there how many, what is the value of n you needed to approximate that function by Taylor's polynomial. So here n is unknown, accuracy is known. So based on known accuracy, you have to find n. And here n is known, based on known n, you have to find what is the error. So two questions are coming here. One question is given n, find what is error. Given error, find what is n. That means how many n you will need. Okay, so that is the concept. Two question would come in error approximation or error analysis or approximation of a function. So we will just discuss that in detail. So prior to discuss that, I will take few example of Taylor Taylor's polynomial approximation of f function. After that, we will do error analysis. So here I am taking two examples. Simplest example, I would like to take that sin x. So suppose our intention is that we are taking a function sin x, and we try to approximate this function by various Taylor polynomial t1, t2, t3 up to t15. So we'll try to see what are these Taylor's polynomial for this sine function function at zero, x not equal to zero. So that nature we will see it here. You can see that this easily you can see that for various n. So keep on varying n, you will see various different kind of approximation of the function. So as n is increasing, you are seeing that better approximation of the sine function by corresponding Taylor's polynomial. So Taylor's polynomial are EG function, and from that EG function you try to approximate your sine function with the help of Taylor's polynomial. So you can see that what is value of n depends upon n, just how many terms you need. So based on that you are getting various term here, like that. That is the approach. It is coming. Okay. So now further we will take another function. We will try to find various Taylor polynomial for that function. So another function, we are taking it like this way. Suppose we are taking function, a logarithmic function, log 1 plus x, and we know that this function is defined when x is less than 1, when modulus of x is less than 1. Okay. Okay, so for this function we try to find a Taylor's approximation of various Taylor approximation of this function in the neighborhood of 0, in the neighborhood of 0. So how you can see it like this way. So simply this is the function. We are focusing in a very small neighborhood of 0. This one is talking about very small neighborhood of 0. So here in the very small neighborhood of 0, we can see the various Taylor polynomial which are going to approximate the function. Various t1, it will be just a linear complete line, t2 it would be quadratic, and likewise it will go on. All these are polynomials. So there are various polynomial, we can see it here like this way. Okay, so now another function we are taking it here, e to the power minus x times sin x. So again, again your question would be there, how to find Taylor's polynomial. So Taylor's polynomial, you can easily find that it is all about how to determine the coefficient. So coefficient here in Taylor polynomial are determined by the corresponding derivative of the function at the given point x not equal to 0. So you have to determine the various order derivative of the function at x not equal to 0, and just as a coefficient and divide by corresponding that factorial. So here approximation, you can see it like this way. So keep on increasing the term in the Taylor's polynomial. If you are taking linear, then here you can see that in the display, if you are taking first term, linear would come here. So if you include second term as well, x square, then quadratic would come here, then cubic, then quantic, and it will go on like that way, in that fashion. So as number of terms in the Taylor polynomial is increasing, you see function is improving, approximation is improving. So that concept you can see that any function can be approximated in a better way by increasing number of terms in the Taylor polynomial. If function is enough smooth, in that process we can do that. Okay. So other thing we'll discuss about that, what is the behavior of Taylor polynomial if you go away from that current point at about which you are finding the derivative of the function. You are trying to approximate that function in the neighborhood of x naught. If you go away, so situation would be not much fine, but you say that. So that's where approximation by Taylor's polynomial, if you go away from x naught, so what nature you will see that generally Taylor's polynomial of higher order better approximate the function than Taylor's polynomial of lower order, only in local in some local neighborhood of x naught, only in local neighborhood of x naught. But if you go away from x naught, approximation would be not guaranteed that higher would have better approximation and lower order polynomial would have less better approximation. So you will see some reverse structure that. So few example I have taken it here like this way. So we are taking an exponential function, and for that exponential function, just try to consider two Taylor polynomial. One is T2, and that means Taylor polynomial of degree 2 of exponential function, and Taylor polynomial of degree 3 of exponential function. Okay. So you can see it in this function. And if you try to see the nature of this function, so this easily you can say that your question would be there here, what is x naught? So we are defining Taylor's polynomial in the neighborhood of x naught equal to 0, and the corresponding function is exponential function. F of x is here exponential, and with respect to this function we come up with this Taylor polynomial. So we try to find difference of the function, that means how much error is there at x, call it x1 equal to -4. Another point, -4 is definitely, it is very far away from 0. So if you are trying to see the error, call it error terms, between, that means difference between magnitude of difference between function value x at -4 and value of second order Taylor polynomial at -4, then if you see, then this is the magnitude of difference, and this magnitude of difference is less than this magnitude of difference. This one is the difference between f -4 and t3 of -4. So t3 is one higher degree Taylor polynomial. So here even the higher degree Taylor approximation is not good, it is bad than that means t2 is better than t3 when you are trying to approximate the function at x1 equal to -4. In that case we see that t2 is behaving better, giving better approximation than t3. So that's why higher this concept is not valid when you go away from the localness. When you go away from x naught, that time you observe that this concept is not valid, this approximation. That means with increasing the degree of polynomial, you want to get a better approximation. It is not working away from the point x naught, away from the neighborhood. Okay, so that is the concept. Simply I would like to say that is the t2. Simply you can say that here in this case T2, it is having a better approximation of the function at point x equal to -4 than T3. Okay, now we take another example that we take two polynomial T3 and T5 Taylor polynomial for function sin x in the neighborhood of x not equal to 0. So if you are taking this, then again we can see similar situation, that if we come up with one point x1 that happens to be 5π/4, then at this point we observe that t3 is providing better approximation of the function at point 5π/4 than t5. So again here the increasing order of the Taylor polynomial, it is not working fine if you go away from the neighborhood point, if you go away from the points. So that's why you can see that here the approximation is here better. This approximation T3 is a better approximation of the sine function at 5π/4 than T5. So here, so that's where Taylor's theorem, when you are talking about Taylor's theorem, and when it is working very fine in the local neighborhood of the given point, local neighborhood. So that's why it is a very much a local property. Okay. So here, few more example I have taken here. So simply, if we only need a prediction for a few instant around one point, the initial position. So initial position, the velocity may be good enough. So it is like one kind of just I'm trying to give a physical meaning of Taylor's polynomial. So it is coming like this way. That means you try to predict the value of function for a few instant around our point. Suppose we are standing at a point, from there we try to predict about the value of function, then what will happen? That means we are having initial position, and we know that from which velocity it will go deviate, evaluation will proceed further. So that's way the simply we will say that f of x can be approximated by suppose 0 is the initial position, the at that we are having functional value f of 0, and this one is talking about velocity. This value, through this velocity you are just moving away. Okay, so that's where f of x can be approximated by this linear approximation. So simply we can call it, it is a linear model of the function of the given function. It is a linear model of the function where how it is defined? It is approximation is defined through initial position plus velocity effect. So the first derivative is always talking about velocity effect. So velocity effect is changing the position. So that's how much change it brings. So this change it brings from the initial position. This changes, or you can also say later I will call it search direction, or another name would be there that you will see that later. So velocity, due to velocity effect, that function f, it just moves by this amount. So that this one is a linear f model of f, and if you try to track some more information about the model, that means if you are having idea of acceleration as well, we are adding acceleration as well, in that case what we will have a quadratic model of the function. That means we are having initial position where we are adding velocity effect, then we are also adding acceleration effect. So initial position, simply it would be the value of the function at that point, that initial point. If 0 is the initial position, by default generally we are taking 0 as an initial, x not equal to 0 initial position, then this one is we are calling it velocity effect, and this one we are calling it acceleration effect. So acceleration effect, it is dealing with second derivative. Okay, so this is the quadratic model of the function. Likewise, you can generalize for various other cubic model by quadratic model. So as we get further from a starting point, we need more terms to keep our prediction accurate. Okay, in order to predict the value of function. So here it is, in right hand side we are talking about prediction, the value of prediction of the function, because we don't know actual value of the function at x, we don't know, and even that function would be very much complicated to find value at x. But in right hand side it is very easy to compute the value of function with the corresponding Taylor polynomial, because it is a polynomial, it is dealing with x, x square, x cube kind of thing. So cubic and finding cube and a square of numbers, that one is not a very tedious task, you can always perform. So okay, so you can say that these are the predicted value, what we call it, and this predicted value, if you are talking about this predicted value, then also we can say that whether it is very much near to f of x or not. So that also we need to talk about. So we do prediction of the value of the function from the Taylor's polynomial. With the help of Taylor's theorem, we try to come up with prediction of the function. Okay. So as much as you increase the terms, your prediction would be much more better. Keep on increasing, adding the terms, your prediction would be much more better. So it is one kind of what we call it physical visualization of Taylor's theorem. Okay, so I think, do we have time? Okay, other thing we will discuss in next class. Next class we will discuss in detail about application of Taylor's theorem. Various application you will see it here. And after discussing a lot about Taylor's